YouTubers, today I want to do something a little bit different from the usual subject matter. Like most of you, I've been watching the Dragon Ball Super Broly movie trailer like a million times, and I've also been trying to keep up with some of the major news surrounding the upcoming movie. I know this will actually kind of sound strange, but I'm sure like a lot of y'all, I want to know everything that they're showing us, but I also want to go into the movie as fresh as possible. But that doesn't stop me from wanting to really figure out how everything in the movie is going to play out. So I really thought it would be a very fun thought and creative experiment in order to outline what I believe the Dragon Ball Super Broly movie is going to be based on with all the footage and all the context that we've been given thus far. And if you're familiar with my channel at all, you guys know I love to kind of throw out these crazy, ridiculous pitches for what I think the overall story of Dragon Ball should be. So with that being said, let's just jump right into this. We open up on a space view shot of a desolate planet in the middle of nowhere as a classic Frieza ship moves into frame. Various voices give the audience context that the Frieza Force is once again up to its usual ways. A squad of grunts is sent to investigate the surface level of the planet, and they are shocked to find a very powerful warrior living amongst the ruins. This is Broly. The orange alien that we see in the trailer is quickly dispatched by the legendary Super Saiyan before Paragus steps in and uses his mind control device in order to spare the green woman. Paragus notices the scouters warned by these grunts and instantly knows that they're part of the Frieza Force. Without hesitation, he asks to speak to Lord Frieza. The news is quickly moved through the chain of command until Frieza makes his way to the deserted planet to meet these two isolated Saiyans. Frieza realizes instantly that Broly's power is something special, even if it hasn't been fully refined yet. And in a strange turn of events, Paragus pledges his allegiance to Frieza as he mourns for their loss of their beloved planet Vegeta. Under his breath, he curses Beerus, the god of destruction, for the death of their planet. A wicked smile crosses Frieza's face as we cut to the opening credits. From there, we jump to Beerus and Whis zipping through the entire universe in order to make their way to the Capsule Corp for the latest party. Let's just say that it's Pan's first birthday in order to ease the reference as to where this is taking place after the Tournament of Power. So basically, a year has gone by, a year and some change really, and Goku is really looking for his next major challenge. During this party, a strange energy approaches the planet that alerts even Beerus. This is something that he says that he's felt before, but he can't really seem to recall where he felt it. When the others sense it too, they set out to the Arctic regions in order to investigate where this is coming from, but they're shocked to find another Frieza Force ship on planet Earth. And it's with that Frieza exits the ship to meet Goku and Vegeta, who are the first to arrive. Everyone else is taking their sweet time to get there by taking Bulma's ship, but this allows us for some fun comedic scenes between Beerus, Whis, and everybody else. Frieza approaches Goku and Vegeta and explains that he has come to receive the wish promised to him before participating in the Tournament of Power. He needs to bring back something to life. Vegeta is quick to remind him that he no longer needs his wish because Whis brought him back to the life at the end of the tournament. Frieza laughs and says that it isn't his life that he's going to be reviving, but that of the Saiyan race. Vegeta is in complete shock by this, and Frieza is just completely beside himself as he recalls the massive potential of the Saiyans that was showcased during the Tournament of Power. Frieza explains in a cryptic fashion that he was tricked into being fearful of the Saiyans' potential when he should have been fostering it all along. He wants to use the promise of a Dragon Ball wish in order to correct that mistake of his. Behind him, Paragus and Broly emerge from the ship, and Goku and Vegeta acknowledge Broly as the warrior giving off such a strange energy that they felt before. Paragus recognizes his prince and attempts to communicate with him, but Frieza is really quick to interrupt, claiming that the prince has already sought the Dragon Balls once in order to wish for eternal life. In fact, the Saiyan prince has had multiple opportunities to wish back his people, but instead has forgotten about his planet, his people, and most importantly, his Saiyan pride. Right here, we see that Frieza is really playing heavily into Paragus's core beliefs as a Saiyan, and using everything that Vegeta's been saying over the last couple years in order to work around and make Paragus not like Vegeta. It's really clever on his part, and I think that this would be a great addition to the movie. Anyway, it's this revelation that forces Paragus to instruct Broly to fight Vegeta, as the main thrust of the film's conflict gets underway. As the trailer suggests, Vegeta takes it upon himself to fight Broly at the beginning, but Broly's ever-increasing strength eventually gets the better of him. This eventually forces Goku to step in and take over after Vegeta is briefly taken out of the match. While it appears that Broly cannot actually compete with Goku and Vegeta at the beginning, Goku has to go through his various Super Saiyan transformations only to realize that this new Saiyan has an ability that matches him every single step of the way. In the meantime, Vegeta, who we've already suggested is briefly out of the fight, is approached by Paragus, who shares with him the backstory of where they've been this entire time. As it turns out, Paragus was an elite Saiyan who served under Vegeta's father and Frieza, but instead of serving through brute force, he helped with his scientific mind and was never much of a fighter. But his son was different, very strong and gifted, even from birth. Broly grew into a young man and caught the interest of King Vegeta and was quickly promoted through the higher ranks of the Saiyan elite's force in order to actually serve as the king's personal guard. And of course, this made Paragus so incredibly proud of his son and the honor that it brought on their family. But one day, Planet Vegeta was visited by an unwelcome guest in the form of Beerus the Destroyer. The God of Destruction insulted the king and robbed him of his pride, and this sent Broly into an absolute rage, the likes of which the Saiyan race has never seen before, as the young Saiyan stepped up and fought the God of Destruction on a one-to-one match, and even getting a few shots in the process. But such an onslaught was just useless, as Beerus quickly made work of the young Saiyan, sending a death beam straight through Broly's heart and leaving him for dead. But it's this outburst from Broly that actually drives Beerus to order Frieza to blow up Planet Vegeta while he sleeps. And later, it's Beerus' recollection of this that actually brings the Oracle Fish to predict his fight with the Super Saiyan God when Super actually began. And needless to say, Broly actually survives this attack with Beerus, but is extremely weakened in the process. As he heals, this allows him to undergo an extreme Zenkai boost. But because of Broly's extreme strength that he showed with his rage boost, King Vegeta is completely fearful of the consequences of this power, and he banishes Paragus and Broly from the planet. This is a calculated effort to promote the survival of the species on King Vegeta's part, as he understands the fragile alliance that they have with Frieza, and he's very fearful of Beerus returning with any wrath directed at Broly or the Saiyan race in general. And from that banishing, we do get a reimagining of Frieza's destruction of Planet Vegeta, and maybe if you want, we can get a little recap of Goku's departure from the planet and introduce Bardock and Jine in the movie as well, but it doesn't have to be the main focus of the story. But with their banishment, Broly and Paragus end up on a planet that we met them at the beginning of the movie, and we quickly learn that in fact this is Planet Sidala from Universe 7. It's just been completely abandoned. And in the meantime, with their banishment, the two of them actually miss the real cause of Planet Vegeta's destruction, and they wrongfully assume that it was actually caused by the God of Destruction, who was mad after Broly attacked him. And you can see how this thought would actually breed a growing hatred in Broly's heart, as the thought of Beerus sends him into a slow spiral of rage that only serves to increase his power. And this actually sends Paragus in a desperate effort to control his son, using his knowledge to create a device that allows him to control Broly's mind and keep his power at bay. And as the years go by, Paragus shares with Broly the history of their people, the power of the Saiyans, and the creation of the first Super Saiyan and Super Saiyan God. This is where we get a lot of our history from the Saiyans and probably recreate what we know about the Saiyans, where they came from, and everything involved in that. Probably for more of a future use, sequels, and also anything else that they do with the Dragon Ball series. This is really about just telling Broly's story and coming full circle with where Dragon Ball Super began and having what I would consider a closure for Beerus, Broly, Goku, Frieza, and Vegeta's character along with the Saiyan history. Anyway, of course, one of the things that we would be showing is that these flashbacks are really much intermixed with the fight going on between Goku and Broly, and as the people on the sidelines watch from afar with a lot of comedic moments thrown in, it's not going to be doom and gloom the entire time. And Frieza, watching all of this, is completely besides himself with the power and prospect of harnessing the Saiyan's potential for his own gain. Remember, this is the same Frieza that we met in the Tournament of Power. He still wants to muddle under his breath that he's going to take over the multiverse, and Zeno and all the Gods of Destruction won't be in power for long. This is still his driving force, and he wants to use the Saiyan power in order to do that. And remember, Paragus is watching this fight as he explains the story to Vegeta, sharing his hatred for Beerus and his remorse that Vegeta's resolve is as weak as his father's. And Vegeta, in a scene resembling his death on Namek, picks himself up off the ground and tells Paragus that it wasn't Beerus that destroyed Planet Vegeta, but Frieza. This revelation shatters Paragus' worldview as he confronts Frieza, who doesn't even deny the accusation. Paragus lashes out at Frieza, but he's quickly put down by his emperor, and this drives Broly just completely crazy as the death of his father sends him roaring after Frieza. And despite not showing it through transformations, Broly's power completely knocks Frieza off guard with the power that he's gained with his fights with Goku and Vegeta. Frieza fights back in his golden form, but he is quickly taken down as Broly's anger awakens the legendary Super Saiyan form. And once again, Goku is forced to team up with Frieza in order to fight a much more powerful foe, but this time it's just too much for them. Broly easily overpowers the two and seemingly kills them both in the process of destroying the planet. And it's here where Beerus takes his stand and instructs Whis to use his reverse time technique in order to step in and try to kill Broly himself. And this is our last fight of the movie, and the one that takes us full circle for the entire story. This is the one with the most lasting consequences, as Beerus sacrifices himself in order to stop the onslaught of Broly, saving planet Earth in the process. Frieza escapes in the confusion, but after Broly is defeated, everything seemingly goes back to normal. Because Whis has already used his ability, he cannot use it to save Beerus' life, and the God of Destruction of Universe 7 is in fact dead. He's dead in the same way that Elder Kai is dead, so he actually still gets his body, and he can hang out and eat and everything else like that. He's just allowed to be a little bit more lazy than he actually was. But because he's actually dead, Whis has to really express interest again in appointing Goku and Vegeta as the Gods of Destruction, but Goku yet again refuses. He smiles though and says that maybe he has someone in mind, but it's going to take a couple years, as Whis jokes about Beerus never doing his job in the first place, so that doesn't really matter. Everyone has a good laugh, and we cut to credits. Hey guys, I hope you guys enjoyed this. Like I said, this probably won't happen in the movie, but this was just my first attempt at trying to pitch what the overall story of Dragon Ball Super Broly would be based off all the footage that we actually have. So what are your thoughts on this? Share your pitches in the comment section below, and hopefully, you know, sometime in the future we can actually do another one of these pitch videos. I'm sure there are so many different stories you can tell around this. I was just trying to figure out a way where these characters, this story could actually make sense, and whether or not it does, or this is the way the movie plays out, I cannot wait for the movie. I am just super excited to have Dragon Ball back in any real way, shape, or form, and this movie looks fantastic. So I hope everyone's having a fantastic day. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe. Hit that bell over by the subscriber button to notify you every single time I upload. It's been real.